Hello all, welcome along to another Mindburner video. This time I'm looking at the KORG Polysix. Picked one up on eBay there for a little money, I think $5.95. Faulty, with a lot of noise and just distortion on it. So I don't have one of the KORG Polysixes. I do have a KORG Poly61, which I really like. It's quite a basic synth, but you know, it sounds great. So I've always wanted a Polysix, which they say is better. It's more analogue, more controls. So I decided to take a punt on this. So hopefully you'll stick with me while I go through it and try and repair the machine. It should arrive really any day, so yeah, hopefully have a bit of fun fixing it up, and so stick with me. I think this video will be quite long, but it may end up being in two parts, one with the repair and then maybe one with calibration and stuff like that. Okay, so I've just opened up the Poly6. Just four screws on the top on this machine. Just having a wee quick look across the boards. And the first thing to notice is that the battery has been changed at some point for another 3.6 volt battery, not the sort of usual replacement, which is like a 3 volt battery, but sort of something similar to the original one that was in it. Now, there are some leaky traces on the board, and I don't know if they've been fixed. Maybe the battery's been changed, but maybe the traces haven't been sorted. So that could be something. But everything else looks in order. I mean, looks in order, I should say. I mean, I don't know if it is or not, but over here on the right, we have the filter board and mains transformer and mains input. Then we have the voice board with the SSMT 244. I think it's a filter and 256 envelope chip. Lots of trimmers. And then the rest of the voice board here with the keyboard connector. And I think there's a chip underneath there, which is the keyboard assigner. It's a CPU of some sort. And then over to the dreaded board, the dreaded battery board, CPU board, which isn't in bad condition. And then the effects board, which has the chorus, etc. on it. And then the control panel. So how does the machine actually sound? Well, here you go. Hopefully you can hear the kind of distortion that's on the note there. Like a ringing. I've actually heard that before, and it was a faulty op amp which caused the problem. Lots to check. This may be a bit premature, but I noticed the signal test point on the voice board. So I thought I'd just use my trusty audio probe here, which is just wired into a speaker, to check and see if the distortion is present on the output of the board. That would kind of eliminate the effects board as being the culprit, because if the problem's present here, then it's in the voice board. So yep. It's on there, so the problem's in the voice board somewhere, or before that, in the CPU board. So just looking at the area around the battery, not a great repair attempt, if it's been repaired at all. The original IC is still there, and looks bodged, and in a pretty bad sort of situation. This is probably something to do with the voice issues. You can just see that. Like, it appears that the majority of problems with these machines are the battery. The next thing being, you know, the keyboard contacts being a problem. I'm sure there's other problems with, you know, voice chips and things like this that can happen. there's lots of 4-0 logic there, but you know, this definitely seems to be a KORG killer. I know my Poly 61 suffered from this acid battery rot, or is it alkaline, I think, which comes out and then eats through the tracks, rendering channels useless and stopping communication. So I've got the KORG Poly 6 on the bench now, and I'm just going to check the voltages. One of the first things you should really do is check the power supply on a synth. So that's the earth. And the first one here is plus 15. So I'm getting 14.89, close enough, 14.9. Could do with a tweak, but it's probably not the cause of the problem. The minus line, 14.93, yeah, good enough. And the 5 volt rail, 4.96, yeah, perfect, pretty much. So that seems okay. I thought I would just try checking my KORG Poly 61, and right enough it has the SSM256 chips in as also. So I swapped out one of them from the KORG Poly 6 and put it into the Poly 61, and sure enough it's fine. So I'm making an assumption that the rest of the chips are okay, at least that they're not responsible for the distortion anyway at this stage. Started to check some of the op-amp outputs on the voice board. There's three here responsible for the combined output, I believe, of the board. And I thought I'd just check the output of one, the audio probe. Don't know if you can hear that, but the distortion's present there. So at that stage, the distortion there exists. Well, it's just out of shot of the video. There are a number, well, three 4066 chips, which I'm going to just check the input into. Wow, that sounds like a clear tone. No distortion. This would be before it goes into the voice processing circuitry. So the distortion doesn't seem to be here, but the distortion still could be coming from the CPU board with incorrect voltages being applied to maybe the envelope generator or something else. So I still suspect the CPU board, but it's just interesting that there is a clear tone there. Don't know exactly what that means yet. Okay, so I removed the KLM367A CPU board. And someone has attempted to repair the board. I don't know how successfully. Now this might have been okay at one point, but acid has continued, or alkaline has continued, to go through the board and destroy things. So it looks like I'm going to have to really redo this. So I decided to check the traces underneath the battery, and I downloaded this printout from the old Crow's website. He deserves a lot of credit really for putting this up online. It's an old website, but it's really, really handy. And he's kindly sort of shown the traces that they should really check on a typical battery leak. These may or may not be the ones you need to fix, but certainly a lot of these will be suspect. Now, so I've been going through in mine and checking them, and a number are okay. But this one on pin, I think it's pin 8, which goes through to the end pin in this resistor, seems to be dead. So I'm just going to double check that now with a continuity meter. I'm just going to check my leads. Yep. So this pin should go to this via, and there's nothing there. And the via then should go to this pin underneath the resistor network that does, but again nothing here. So that's the first dead one, so I'll have to repair that. I'm not sure if you can see this, but here one of the chips looks a bit badly soldered in. It looks like it's been taken out at some point and then maybe replaced, but a socket wasn't used, which I always think is really a false economy. You should always really put a socket in if you can. Sometimes height won't allow that, but in this case a socket should have been put in. So I'm going to remove this and see if I can clean this up a bit. Upon removing this IC that was really gummed up with solder, it's a wee bit of a mess. It's not terrible, but it's certainly not that pretty. So that's what it looks like there. Now, there's a couple of the little pads there I nearly lifted. It's because there's so much solder on it, it was plastered. So I used my new funky gun, desoldering gun, which was great. So that really helped things. I did notice here, if you can see, there's a track and it looks like acid damage. So upon checking continuity, there's continuity there at the end of the track, but not on the other side of it. And not here where I've made a little scratch mark. Now I followed this down to this point. If I go to the scratch mark, getting continuity, I follow it back up to this pad, there's nothing. So there's another fault. Just shows you that acid can get underneath these ICs and destroy a trace. Or perhaps the trace was destroyed when the chip was lifted too forcefully, sometimes using kind of like a wedge like this, which, you know, you can kind of go underneath and force the chip up, but you damage the circuit board underneath. I've done it myself, actually. It's, you know, a pretty stupid thing to do, but, you know, in a rush, when you're late at night, it's the kind of thing you can do and then not notice when you put the new chip in, you've damaged the trace. So someone's definitely been at this before, because there's burn marks around the connectors here, which is kind of a classic giveaway where somebody's iron has touched that while they were soldering or desoldering something. Again, an easy thing to do, but just shows you it's been bodged. So that's a kind of, that's a really good one to find, that this was disconnected here, there, but not there. So it stops there and it's like nothing here. So I'm gonna jumper that. Excuse me while I go handheld for a while here and just manually point the camera through my magnifier. So you can see there that I've cleaned the tracks up, and if I can just go down here, you can see, you know, this is the gap that was eaten through or damaged. It does look like acid damage to me, because if you did it with a, you know, like a pry tool or a screwdriver, it would probably be more of an indentation in the board. So I'm going to repair this. Okay, so testing some of the ICs here on the CPU board, I've noticed that one of the 4042s, the D-latch, one of the gates is bad. So if I just scan through it on my cheapo tester, gate 4 comes up as bad. So I've tried it various different ways. Now sometimes you can get this result if, you know, the IC's been pulled and the leg is maybe a bit corroded or grotty, but I've cleaned all that up and tried it several times and still getting the same result. So that looks like there is a problem there. So that's kind of progress. Now what this will fix or do, I'm not too sure as yet. While waiting for some parts to arrive for the CPU board, I decided to take the control panel boards out of the machine just to have a look at them. There's a couple of chips on board here, a couple of multiplexers, 4051s, which mucks all the different control signals from the potentiometers. Bit of a weird thing happening. I noticed that some of the controls, when they work, seem to work in reverse. So for instance, you know, like the envelope control, rather than it being really sharp, turned left, fully left, it's sharp to the right. Like the filter as well would be like fully open, sort of to the left, and then closed to the right. So it seems to be reversed. I don't know if that's anything to do with these, but I'm going to check them anyway. Just see if there's a problem. Probably okay, but really nothing else going on at the minute, so I thought I'd just check these out anyway. So I've done a lot of work to this CPU board here, and I basically resocketed everything. If you can see, all the op amps have been done, logic chips with good quality sockets, really carefully soldered. I did a good job on it, I think, and the result, the machine still sounds like the clangers. Yeah, I don't know whether this board is actually faulty and there's another fault somewhere on it that I've missed, or this is actually working and the rest of the machine, there's something wrong with that. It's really hard to know because I've inherited a machine with work done to it, non-working, and I don't know really what state the machine is in, so I can't get a baseline. So what I've decided to do is order one of the clone boards for this KLM board here. There's a helpful chap on eBay supplies the PCBs. I'm going to build it myself, so I'm going to document that when I get the board, and I'm going to do that carefully so that at least what I consider a known good that I can try in here and see if it improves things. I've replaced more or less everything and checked everything. This is a DAC IC which I've replaced as well, and it had a lot of goo underneath it, but that didn't seem to make a difference either. Adjustment wise, maybe the thing was off, but it couldn't be off so much that it doesn't do anything to make this kind of distorted sound. So I think I've gone as far as I can with this at the minute. Now, I checked a lot of the resistors as well, the values, which are usually okay. I replaced a couple which were about 30% off, but again, probably fine. You know, wouldn't have thrown the machine off this much, potentially. One thing I did notice when looking at the rest of the machine is on the voice board that the key assigner IC has been replaced, this D8049, by a part from vintagesynthparts.com. So dear knows what else has happened to this board and what's been replaced and what's happened in the past. One thing I did check was that this optocoupler was okay. Now you can check this by probing the pins of this op amp that's close beside it here, to see if there's any spurious voltages. Anything like 13 volts on any of the pins shows that this could be a fault. Another indication would be that the entire keyboard range is off quite a bit and it won't tune. And each key is off by the same amount, i.e. the difference between each key and each semitone is, you know, the same, but the whole thing's just right off. So that can be replaced with a modern equivalent, I think. Quite hard to get. But on this one, it seems okay. Okay, while waiting for parts to arrive, I thought I'd actually have a go at trying to do some of the adjustments in the service manual. So there's a first one is a thing called reset, and there's an adjuster here on the CPU board. And what should happen is you essentially put a 56k resistor across this little jumper here in the power supply that kind of loaded up, I suppose, and then you turn this adjuster left to right until all the panel lights come on here on this side, and then that's it, basically set. But when you take off the 56k resistor, it goes back to 1-1. Now I've already done that, that's worked out okay, so that sort of was as per service manual. Now the next thing is a digital to analog converter, which is this chip here, and the adjustment of that. This is where things kind of fall apart. What you're supposed to do is put the machine onto manual and then put this onto test switch on the board here, and you should be able to get a note, which I don't. Now, no amount of tweaking of these two DAC adjustments will get anything more than a very low tone. But if I leave it on test and turn the machine off and put it back on again, something interesting happens. I get a tone, although for a short period of time, before it kind of dies away. So that's interesting. But the DAC adjustment, now I thought maybe I can go ahead with that. So what you have to do is turn this tape enable off and on and look at these lights. Now there should be 1 and 8 lit up, but I can make it 4 and 8. Now it says in the manual, if you get other lights apart from 1 and 8, then tweak these adjusters until you get different lights when you move this back and forward. But no amount of tweaking will allow me to get those lights to change. It's kind of stuck. So this is obviously a fault with the board somewhere. you know, one of the many problems with this board. But it was quite interesting that I was able to actually get something out of it. Of course, the more you move these, then it just goes back to its droney sound, if anything. So, weird. But if I turn the machine off and on again, on test, I get, you know, chromatic playing again. But if I turn the machine off and on, when it's on normal, well, it's back to just the duh sound. So, it doesn't really prove anything, but it does prove, well, proves one thing, I suppose, that the voice board's working. So I went ahead and ordered a replacement clone PCB from eBay, and the seller kindly put in the correct transistors, and apparently there's a couple of little bugs on the board, basically just things that weren't earthed and whatever, so he's put the links in for me also, so that was really helpful. So that's great. So I'm going to go ahead and populate this board, and I'll be doing updates as I go along. So I think I'm getting through the board quite well. I put in all the resistors, and I've put in capacitors, and I'm just working on putting in the sockets now for the chips. So I'm just going to fill them in as I put in the last four. Decided to socket these because it just means in the future it's easier to pull stuff out, although I'm using replacement chips. It's probably going to be reliable, but you know, sockets, why not do it right? So decent quality RS sockets for the most part. These ones aren't as good, they're kind of eBay specials, but I didn't want to order a load more, so just decided to go with the ones I had here. Just using a little bit of blue tack just to hold these while I solder. Quite handy. Not a perfect solution, but it's kind of ghetto, but it works quite well. Okay, so there's all the sockets in, and it's starting to shape up quite nicely. So I've just got to put the trim pots in, switches, battery, crystal, and diodes. So not an awful lot more to do. It's really taken me, a couple of hours to build this. Whilst waiting for my parts to arrive for the clone board, I decided to have another go at repairing the original. Now, I was pretty convinced that my trace work was good around the battery area, and I think it is, and I've cleaned it up nicely. So the board was still non-functional, so I decided to just go through all the ICs again. Now, I'd replaced most of them, but I didn't replace this one down at the bottom, which is a LM339N. Let's just, if you can see it there. 339. I discovered that the controls for NG weren't working, so the delay and the level weren't working properly, and this turned out to be the culprit. I don't know why I missed this chip, but yeah, that was a problem. Another thing was the comparator chips over here. I couldn't set the DAC, and I believe it was because of one of these chips. These 33, I think it's 393 comparators, was faulty. So they were changed, and now I actually get something in tune. I was able to set the DAC, which is great. The only problem is now that the envelope controls seem a bit strange, that the attack's very, very sharp, and it's almost all off scale, like not aligned properly or something. So I know there's an adjustment that you can tweak here on the voice board. I think it's VR12 for the attack, but you need a decent oscilloscope. Now I have one, but it's an old analogue scope, and it can't really display sampled and hold waveforms for certain like ranges. So it'll just show me like, you know, that the thing's outputting, but I can't actually look at them and compare. So it's really not an awful lot of use, bar past seeing if something actually has a signal or not, which you can generally do with a logic probe anyway. So I may have to invest in a good oscilloscope at some point, a hand tech or something cheap. But it's good news anyway with the board. Now I'm still waiting to build my clone board, so I'm kind of hoping that when it arrives, it'll be brilliant and everything will work perfectly. But it just shows you can get these old boards fixed up with a little bit of patience. I thought the RAM chip was faulty. I ordered another one, but I think it's okay, because it can't actually store the memory. That's the RAM chip there. I think I mentioned previously that one of these 14042 ICs was faulty, or at least one of the gates was faulty, so I replaced it. That's that chip there. Well, that's a thermistor. It's not actually a capacitor, it's a thermistor.